We should talk about how we met.
Mm.
I feel like I've been monologuing so much. I want you to kind of start off on that. When did you just discover the amazing Mr. Justin?
I know it is such an eye-rolly thing to say, but it was, I feel like it was love at first sight for me. Like, I know that's really eye-rolly, and it's really probably cringy.
It's a little Disney-ish.
But there was a online forum that was specifically for
homeschoolers.
Yeah, homeschool graduates. And I think it's now defunct. Like, it's not.
Yeah, it's really, no more, but yeah.
Yeah, it's no more. But I got on the summer after I turned 18 and saw a profile picture on there, and it was just completely smitten. And I was pretty upset because this guy lived pretty much on the other side of the country. And he seemed perfect.
I had a bit of a lightning bolt moment with you when I first saw your profile. I pretty much just thought you were super cute and just super my type. I was just like, man, this is great. And you were funny. And you were very self-deprecating and cool. Like, you were just like made for me, so to speak. And I don't really believe that. Like, it's not, that's such a fundy sounding thing to say.
I was created to be your helpmate, right?
Not what I mean. I mean, you seemed perfect for what I was looking for. Because it was really easy. It's easy for me to talk to easygoing people.
Yeah.
Because I'm able to mask a lot less and obsess over where I am. And like people who are like very, who kind of make a point to be approachable.
Yeah.
Are definitely my type. And so I felt very comfortable talking to you. And I was like, you are also super gorgeous. And like, I'm really attracted to you. But like we didn't just go jump right into it. We were like actually just friends and acquaintances for a long time.
Yeah. For years. Like 2.5 years. And we were both in other relationships. And we didn't talk. We didn't talk that whole time. It was very much, you know, kind of message here and there.
Yeah.
You know, but there was, we'd go months without talking to each other, you know? And I think I was pretty much 100% convinced that it wasn't ever going to go anywhere.
Same.
You know, because I felt like with my specific family situation, you know, I mean, I didn't think that a long distance relationship was going to be an option, let alone a long distance relationship with a random guy that I met online, you know.
Seemed impossible.
Yeah, it did. And it really took, you know, me kind of trying to do things the way that I was being told to do things and, you know, enter courtship with a guy that filled these certain qualifications on paper, you know, and was like objectively like a good person and, you know, stable, these different things, and being wildly unhappy and feeling like I was losing myself, you know. It really took that for me to be like, okay, fine, I like you.
Yeah.
And take that first step in just acknowledging that you know, I had feelings for you.
So for me, I had left that place where I'd kind of figured out what my truth was and figured out what my faith was. And by the way, it took years to unpack all the fundamentalism stuff. So it wasn't just like this clean, like, oh, I'm woke now, you know?
Oh, yeah, no.
Oh, I believe everything, you know, in a very, well, I was conservative.
Yeah.
At that point.
Until, like, I mean, we both were until well after we got married.
Like, in my heart, I really felt kindness and things towards people, but I was still unpacking a lot of negative beliefs.
Yes.
That to this day, I'm a little bit, they went longer than I wish they had on some of them. And so, you know, the process is not overnight. You don't just get the lightning bolt moment and go, oh, fundamentalism is bad. And then suddenly you're this like woke person who's a joy and a gift to the world and all that stuff. It like it takes time. And I have a lot of compassion for people who it takes years in, because boy, did it take years for me. You're literally building your life from nothing.
Yeah, and it's because it isn't this thoughtless, reactionary, you know, response where you're just like, oh, fuck all of that. You know, it's very much a slow, painful process of unpacking things and working through things. And yeah, it took years. It's taken years for both of us. And I know we still have, you know,
still have things working on.
Yeah.
I mean, I've had things I've learned that I didn't know about, you know, how to talk about trauma, how to be sensitive to others, how to, how to, you know, talk through certain issues over the last week or two that I didn't know. And I fully embraced those things.
Yeah.
Like, I love it. But yeah, no, I mean, I'm very comfortable with change at this point in my life in terms of like personal stuff. Like it's, I've kind of got it down to a routine where it's like, oh, so I'm wrong on that too. All right, let's throw that out in the waste bin and then figure out what's true.
Yeah.
And all the events that have happened in the country nationally have made a huge impact on me, from, you know, Black Lives Matters to a lot of the stuff that happened in the fallout of 9/11 and a lot of the conversations we've had nationally about other religions, to immigration, to the way that I view LGBTQ plus, you know, initiatives and lifestyles.
Yeah. Yeah.
I've kind of been following all these things and been impacted by national conversations as they happen or by people that I meet.
Yeah.
So, you know, there's like a very personal reason behind why I'm quote unquote progressive or whatever for each issue. And in some ways I feel good about that, because I know when I do change, everything's deep.
Yeah.
It's deeply held.
Mm-hmm.
It's not just surface stuff. I didn't just get told that this was the way to think and that, you know, okay, I guess I'll just be this, say the right things, just kind of spout them off without meaning it. Now I'm like, nope, I had to tear out all this old stuff, dig deep, and then put this belief in there. So I believe this belief 100% now, and it's firm because I put in a lot of work to get here.
Yep.
So yeah, definitely not an idle thing. But anyway, we kind of rabbit trailed. We were talking about our relationship.
Yeah.
And so I had gone through this deconstruction process. I had met a girl and was kind of having sort of a dating type relationship with her. She and I were both in similar places in terms of needing a lot of encouragement. Mm-hmm. Both of us were neurodiverse. And in some ways, she kind of like beat the out of a lot of old stuff that I believed about women, about feminism, about a man's role, a woman's role.
Mm-hmm.
Like she single-handedly like punched me in the nuts over that stuff, metaphorically, and kind of helped me get my head on right on some stuff. Ultimately, the relationship didn't go anywhere. And actually, you and I were friends while you were courting.
Yeah.
The one guy who was sort of Mr. Perfect. And while I was dating somebody who was helping me discover a lot of things that I had had hangups about and so forth. And in some ways, I'm so grateful for that relationship in my life, because it really helped demystify a lot of things, you know, just in my own soul that I had.
Yeah.
And so when I met you, And then finally, we were both single and talking, and we liked each other, and we had great chemistry, and it was easy to talk to each other, and we both thought each other was attractive.
Mm-hmm.
But there was just kind of these hurdles that were mostly around courtship, fundamentalism, and being a good person. We just kind of both were just like, should we jump? To me, I was like, this is Jana 2.0. I was like, this is the chance to get it right. I was like, all that anxiety and all that, like, oh, I can't even walk across the room and talk to her. And it's been month six of this. I was like, let's throw that out the window, baby. And let's like get this stuff done. And so I pretty much was direct depositing all of my paychecks into airline flights. And I just came out there. We had like contingency plans in place. We were like, if we weird each other out in person.
Because I talked to other guys, you know, message back and forth with other guys where we would get along great messaging, but then you'd see each other in person, you know, not even as like a romantic thing, but you know, we'd see each other in person and there was no talking whatsoever.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just this like, kind of thing. And I was really afraid that was going to happen.
With us.
With you. Yeah.
Yeah. We talked about it and we both agreed that it was a no hard feeling situation.
Mm-hmm.
If that happened to us.
Yeah.
If we talked and it just felt like it wasn't working out.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. We were holding hands and trying not to pull the car over like 10 minutes after meeting, basically.
Oh my gosh, my poor best friend that
watched us
me there.
Because I pulled into a parking lot of an IKEA with a car rental.
It was so cringy. We had to be so cringy because we literally just like locked eyes. And
it was like one of those moments in those movies, like those high school, like where they lock eyes and like some cheesy mute, like Green Day song plays in the background. It was like that. I remember you were in the, was it a bus? Like a, was it a?
It was a little,
a minivan.
Yeah. We drove her mom's van.
So you pulled in, I'm in a Dodge Avenger that I'd rented.
Yeah.
Or something like that. And you and I just locked eyes and just smiled. And it was just like our eyeballs were like computer guided missiles.
Yeah.
And we got in the same car, and I remember the first words we said to each other were just hi, just exchanging hi and just giggling. Like I was like, hi, and you're just like, hi, and just giggled. And I think we were holding hands and stuff like by the time we left the parking lot.
Mm-hmm.
And just head over heels.
Mm-hmm.
Man, that went downhill so fast.
What?
In terms of us stumbling into deeper love, that's what I mean. I don't mean it fell apart fast.
Oh, yeah.
I mean,
well, because initially when we'd first acknowledged that we liked each other, you were like, oh, well, maybe I'll come visit you in like a year. And, you know, we'll just see. And it was like 3 months later, you were flying out.
How long until we got married after we first met?
Is it 9 months later or something? Like that was it.
We were married within 9 months of physically meeting each other.
Literally 9 months later.
Yeah.
Almost to the day. But, you know, part of that was like, we wanted to be together. And even though there was certain things that we both set aside from what we'd been taught growing up, there was a lot of pressure and shame
mm-hmm.
around being physical.
Yeah.
You know, and things like living together, things like that, where it was like, we have to get married. And you definitely had the perspective that, you know, and I totally agree with this, that like, it would have been very hard for me to deal with like crossing lines emotionally, because I would have felt so guilty about it, you know?
And so I was at the point where I was, you know, I wasn't a virgin or anything mm-hmm. like that at that point. And I was struggling with thoughts of guilt, even in the back of my head, meeting you. Cause I was like, this is a fundamentalist, like Christian girl
mm-hmm.
who I've just got this crazy chemistry with.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm this guy who's way down the road on a lot of things.
Mm-hmm.
And in my heart, I just knew where you were at. And I was like, I don't want to hurt you. I don't want to take advantage of you. I don't want to like, I don't want you to cry, you know, mm-hmm. after like making out with you or something and feel mm-hmm. like you did something wrong.
Yeah. Yeah. Because so, even though I didn't really believe a lot of these things for myself, I very much did not want to disappoint people.
Mm-hmm.
And I was very hard on myself for just normal, you know, desires and wanting our relationship to progress because mm-hmm. I felt like I was going to disappoint people. And that was too much for me to handle at the time. I was already dealing with, we were both dealing with some, you know, a lot of tension with, you know, my dad.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Who,
cause I didn't, I said F that to the whole courtship thing.
Yeah. Well, I said it. I moved out of my parents'
house. Well, because I think I actually asked you, didn't I? Like how you wanted to handle that.
You asked me if I wanted you to ask my dad, and I said no.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because I'd already been through that. I'd already been through a courtship, and I hadn't felt seen or heard throughout mm-hmm. any of it. And I didn't want to sign up for that again. Yeah.
I think I would have. I mean, I think I was F that with courtship too. And that wasn't my preference, and that's not what I wanted. But like, I think I would have.
Yeah, I mean, you cared about other things that I cared about, you know. And I think if that had been something that was important to me,
yeah,
you 1,000% would have done that. You know,
it was weird just feeling so like sure in my bones, though. Just like mm-hmm. this is it. I feel bad for saying this to people because I don't actually believe that this is how it has to go every yeah. time. I'm not trying to say that because it's so Disney sounding. Mm-hmm. I kind of want to disclaim it a little bit and say this isn't actually even how I think it has to go or should go all the time. It just no. did. And yeah. it was beautiful.
Mm-hmm. But it was also very stressful.
Oh, yeah. No, it was very, extremely very stressful. But, we it was funny because even though we had a lot of guilt and stuff like that, I feel like we had a hard time staying off each other, so to speak, you know, just chemistry wise.
Yeah.
This might make somebody mad or whatever, I guess, because I don't think we've told everybody. How long did it take me to kiss you?
On our first visit.
How many days?
It was the second day.
It was the next day. Had you ever kissed anybody?
No. No, I didn't even held hands with anybody. Like, I was in a courtship for, like, 4 months, mm-hmm. and we didn't hold hands or anything.
Right, so what was our first kiss? Because I feel like I nailed it in terms of, like, setting and all that.
It was at the beach.
Mm-hmm.
My favorite place.
You know what? I look back at some of the correspondence, too, that I was writing you, and I contrast it with this journal. And I go, like, dang, boy. I was like, you figured some stuff out.
Mm-hmm.
You know, just in terms of, like, being romantic and smooth and, like, funny mm-hmm. and all that compared to where I was before. And I was like, you figured some stuff out.
I think we made each other comfortable.
I think so.
You know, because I was so much more open and relaxed with you than I had been with anybody else.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that was one of the reasons, you know, before we visited, why it was like disclaimers, because I would get so in my head and tongue tied that I would just not talk to guys, and I would be so afraid, you know, I'd be so self-protective, and I just didn't feel self-protective with you, you know.
Mm-hmm. Same. I didn't feel that way with you either. And it actually scared me sometimes
mm-hmm.
how easy it was.
Because
mm-hmm. I was afraid that I was going to step into something and then not think about everything I need to think about until later.
Yeah. Well, and there was the whole inner conflict of you know, being raised where it's like, it's so important that your parents like the person that you're with and things like that, which my mom was, you know, she loved and loves Justin, but it was just at the time there was a lot of conflict there. Mm-hmm. And so then there was the inner turmoil of how can this be right if my parents, if not both of my parents are on board, and am I tricking myself? But also I love him so much and he's perfect, you know, not like you're literally perfect, but you know, it was just like, we fit together so well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I remember, cause I didn't ask your dad.
Yeah.
For permission to marry you.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we talked about that too.
We did, yeah.
And it felt like an important statement of your autonomy,
mm-hmm.
to not do that.
Yep.
And to have you be the person that controlled your destiny.
Yep.
You know, I wasn't trying to get like a cheap move around your dad or anything like that.
No, I was the one that insisted that
yeah.
you not do that because I knew what the answer would be, you know. And I didn't want to give him that power to devastate me.
When we told him, I remember yeah. when we told him that we were engaged and you showed him your ring and you were just like giggling and so happy.
I was very nervous when I told him.
And you giggle when you're nervous. Yeah.
And he laughed at me.
He laughed at you. Yeah. And he ignored me because I said it to him. He didn't even acknowledge that I'd told him.
Mm-hmm.
He just laughed and then looked at you and said, "You sure about this?"
Mm-hmm.
And it's just, I'm so sick of the tough guy patriarch thing.
Yeah.
Like I saw for the first time that compilation of Jim Bob and his responses to the boys asking him for permission for things.
Oh, I don't think.
And he always faked this sort of like dramatic thing for TV, which was the word wow. Like, oh, like the insolence. He's a bad actor, so mm-hmm. it didn't look real anyways. And like having known him back at the time, whatever. There's this like bogus like thing that a lot of fundamentalist dads do where they like pretend to be like really mad about something or concerned because it's just sort of like, I don't know, live action role play of being a badass, I guess.
Yeah.
And, you know, Jim Bob was just being like, wow, wow, I can't believe, wow.
Yeah.
And it's just like, seriously, dude, you're not, do you like this guy or not like him?
Mm-hmm.
If you like him, why aren't you excited about this? And then if you don't like him, why is this your first time having a reaction? Why didn't you already share your concerns or whatever or something before this moment? It just, it, to me, it doesn't make yeah. any sense. And it's just sort of an odd reaction to have. Mm-hmm. But yeah, well, that's pretty common. But that hurt us yeah. both. But we still got married. We went on. I whisked you away to my little...
My little apartment.
My little shitty apartment with no furniture.
And yeah, and our table was a little TV tray.
Our table was a TV tray. We had a inflatable mattress.
Yep. And we'd watch, we'd play Call of Duty on your little.
I had a little tiny Xbox 360 that I never played really. It was just like I had it for my own entertainment sometimes. And we would play Call of Duty together and just giggle and snuggle.
Make little meals in our little tiny kitchen.
Make little meals for ourselves, go shop, be unbothered.
Eat pizza in the bathtub.
Eat pizza in the bathtub that was so tiny it barely fit us. We lived in a very northern state, so it was extremely cold and that apartment would freeze and we would get up and then just go run into the shower to get warmth from mm-hmm. the hot water and would fight over the warm spots.
You always give me the warm spots. You're sweet. I'd basically cry when I got out of the shower because I was so cold.
Yeah.
Oh. We started doing road trips and things like that. And
we just devoured the United States in terms of like everywhere that we could go, we went. Mm-hmm. Like life was an adventure and we mm-hmm. took it. We had kids, two of them. How many years have we been married?
A little over 8 years now.
Yeah. It's been perfect. No struggles whatsoever. We've been just a model. We should probably quit while we're ahead.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah,
no, but you know what? When you get married and you're in the midst of working through all these toxic beliefs and stuff like that, there's going to be some growing pains for sure.
Yeah, another area of growth I feel like people are going to ask about or have asked about, and we're just trying to jam everything in on this last episode,
yeah,
is me and ASD. Mm-hmm. And this is a pretty recent journey. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I won't say which of my children or anything like that, but like it was one of our children that kind of triggered a look into this.
Mm-hmm.
And I found that as I was looking into it, I was identifying to an extreme degree with everything mm-hmm. that I was finding. And so I didn't really accept it for a while, but I had this moment, I remember, where I was watching a TED talk after having taken tests, and I was like, this isn't right. And it kept coming out like super autistic. Mm-hmm. And I was like, what? No. I was like, this thing is broken. You try it. I was like, watch, it'll call you autistic too.
Mm-hmm.
And you would take it and it's like, not autistic. And I'm like, what? This is not right. And then I started being more introspective and started like really thinking about things and realized for myself, without being diagnosed yet, that this was how it was. So I started the process of diagnosis, which I'm actually still going through. And I feel very strongly that people shouldn't use labels on themselves until it's confirmed. Mm-hmm. And the only reason I'm doing it is because I had a talk with the person who's doing my diagnosis, who told me that even though we haven't really dotted the I's and crossed the T's yet, that I was in fact autistic, and
mm-hmm.
that we really are just getting through some formal last steps and whatnot. But it was incredible finding out about this and identifying what my neurodivergence is. I remember telling one person who's still probably a little closer to the conservative side than I am about this. They're not very educated about, you know, mental health or anything. I told them this and they're like, that's what? I guess everybody's just autistic now, kind of a thing.
Mm-hmm.
Seems like it's a fad, like a fun thing that everybody's doing. And I was like, I don't know. I was like, for me, I've just felt this incredible relief. Things that I thought were my fault weren't my fault. Areas where I felt misunderstood and like I lived in a different world than people around me suddenly made sense.
Mm-hmm.
And the struggles that I had with my upbringing too suddenly felt like they were in context. And I cried. Mm-hmm. I cried hard when I realized it for myself, when I internalized it for the first time. And it's literally just increased my quality of life by a massive amount. My communication's better. I feel like I'm able to ask for things from people where I need help. And I'm able to not feel guilty about getting kind of some clarification or some assistance in some mm-hmm. areas. I mean, I've done even simple things like getting fidget toys and, a heavy weighted blanket to sleep under. Or if I feel panicky and meltdowny, you know, I'm able to do things to comfort myself that I didn't know were techniques before. And it's been amazing for me to get this, is because no matter how people see me from the outside, you know, I know who I am on the inside, and this has been incredible for me.
Mm-hmm.
So, that's my journey on it. I felt like it was relevant to the story to understand, I think, some of the depths to which I struggled with things.
Yeah.
To set that context of ASD. But yeah, it's been amazing. And I've loved hearing from all the neurodivergent people in the comments and the stories that I've heard from people who had similar experiences and similar vulnerabilities and struggles. It's just been fantastic. So
yeah,
very, very happy about it.
Yeah.
a little disorganized, but I feel like we're pretty much close to the end. But I also have to tell at least two stories that kind of got hinted at. And I probably need to clarify them a little bit. One of them is John David Wolverine. Which has become kind of a minor phenomenon on Reddit. Because I mentioned that I saw John David and Josh fight one time, and John David turned into basically Wolverine that he went from this mild mannered kind of like, oh, hey guys, like, how's it going type dude to just like, just this fierce beast, you know, that was just like letting his inner animal out.
Yeah.
So the story on that is that sometime after Josh's quote unquote rehabilitation at the pond, which I mentioned in episode one, he got with at least one of my brothers and I and John David. And we went out to my property, my parents' property, and we're kind of walking around and exploring and just doing what boys do. And, you know, kind of just tromping through the woods, breaking off sticks and just having fun and having conversations along the way. You know, I remember talking with Josh and having some deep conversations as we're going through ravines and asking things about his rehabilitation. And I was curious about the subject for myself. And he was very standoffish about it. And I kind of got the hint that it wasn't, you know, something he wanted to go into. But we got to where we were going and some tussle started. And I don't remember if it was just kind of like Josh shoving John David and just sort of being a little bit of a dick, or if they were arguing over something or whatever. But they started fighting and it turned into a real fight. It wasn't impressive at all. It wasn't like a great fight to watch. It was more like in what's that movie? With Hugh Grant and Colin Firth.
Bridget Jones' Diary.
Yeah, the scrap that they do.
Yeah.
Where it's just like really messy and sloppy looking. That's pretty much what this was. Everybody out of breath and it's just like whatever. But John David, he showed some heart. He showed some feeling in that.
Yeah.
And I remember he was quite a bit smaller than Josh. And Josh was pretty strong, and just being impressed with how well he held his own in that little tussle.
Yeah.
So that was great. I don't think they were supposed to fight, and I don't think they were supposed to get like physical with each other. I think that was a big no-no from the brass. My brothers and I generally didn't fight, but sometimes we did, and it wasn't that big of a deal.
Oh yeah, my brothers were constantly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They definitely weren't encouraged to do those sort of things in their family, which very much varied from family to family. Some fundamentalists were like, here's a wooden sword, beat your brother with it. Yeah. It'll make a man out of you. And others were more like the Duggars, where it was just like, no violence allowed. Don't you dare eat your sandwich into a gun shape and point it at your brother. You know, like that sort of stuff.
Yeah.
My family was somewhere in between. But yeah, it was an interesting story. I remember my brother and I taking our shirts off at one point and just kind of just tromping around bare chested and John David, I saw John David and Josh basically Nikeing with discomfort at seeing other dudes with their shirts off. I don't want anybody to speculate or anything or be inappropriate here. All it means is that
they weren't allowed to do that.
They weren't allowed to do that. And it was awkward for them to see boys around them breaking the rules.
Yeah.
It wasn't just, you know, girls doing something like that. Me and my brother kind of stripping down and like jumping around in some water was awkward for them. And they had to keep their shirts on to swim and things like that. And that is the thing that I got in trouble with Michelle about. Where I was like, she's scary, because she approached me, I think the Sunday after or something like that, and kind of gave me a very terse, our boys don't do that. This isn't the sort of thing we do, and we do not fight, and, you know, don't encourage this sort of thing. Okay.
Yeah.
And like, you know, this is something I'll talk to your parents about or whatever, like that sort of a conversation, and just being like, geez.
Words that strike fear.
It did strike fear. I thought she was kind of scary. She kind of still had the sing-songy voice, but she can dial it in. She can get intense. So yeah, so those are the stories. I think with that, we can just kind of wrap up and say goodbye to this podcast series, which has been quite a journey, to say the least.
Yeah.
I hope it's made a difference. I hope that some people are able to feel free and relate to some of the things that we've said. One of the things that I tried to get done for what I thought would be the 12th episode of this was the rights to a song that I cry to when I read it. And that is Running with the Wolves by Aurora.
Yeah.
And I would have probably been playing that as my outro with a little message. And I'll go ahead and give the message. You know, when we were growing up, like we were one of the things that we were taught was this whole shepherd analogy.
Yes, we were sheep.
We were sheep. And, you know, sheep are kind of dumb. They fall out of line sometimes.
They're weak.
They need to have their heels nipped at. They need to be shorn. All growth needs to be taken away. They're silly creatures that just need a big shepherd to look after them and guide them. And outside of the sheep pen are wolves that will tear you apart. And as a sheep, you're taught to be afraid of the outside because it's a scary, scary place. And I guess I just wanted to say, as this song was playing in the background and ramping up, that anybody who knows this environment for themselves that's been in the sheep pen or is still in the sheep pen needs to know that they're not actually a sheep.
Yeah.
They're different wolves that have been penned and told that they're less than they are. And that all I want is for the wolves to be out of the pen and to run free.
Yeah.
And I just wanted to say that that little boy in that journal who was stuck he's running with the wolves now. And I literally want the whole world to join me.
Yeah.
I want every one of my friends from childhood to join me and run with me. I want everybody who's ever been oppressed and told that they're nothing to run with the wolves, to be fierce and free, wild, fast, beautiful, majestic.
Unafraid.
And unafraid. To howl at the moon with your freedom, you know? So, this has been the final episode 4 of I Pray You Put This Journal Away. You guys can email us if you would like at ipraypodcast@gmail.com. You can also DM us or message us on Twitter at ipraypodcast. We'll monitor those very occasionally and respond. And we definitely love hearing from people. But otherwise, we will be done with this chapter and going back to being those free-range wild wolves that we want to be.
Yep.
And raising our two little wolf cubs to be the fiercest, wildest little wolves in the wood.
Yep.
So thank you guys so much for this journey. I hope this continues to heal others, raise questions, and raise awareness.
Yeah.
Goodbye.
Goodbye.